Now that we've tackled a few fraction addition and subtractions with some variables thrown in, I got a little bit more complicated one here for you. Now, we know the drill, right? We're going to find a common denominator here. But how do we find the common denominator? I mean, these are a little bit more unusual denominators than we were dealing with before. Before, we just had a variable or some power of a variable, or maybe that multiplied by some constant. Here, I've got a variable minus a constant. What do we do here? I mean, can we just go over to this fraction, subtract 2 from the numerator and denominator, and that'll give us common denominators? Of course, that would make the numerator 0, and that's kind of weird. Well, you know what we did before? We looked at fractions that didn't have variables and tried to see if that would teach us anything. So let's take a look at that. Imagine we started off with 3/5 minus 2/3. And this denominator is just 2 more than that one. Can we just subtract 2 from the numerators and the denominator here and write that as 1/3? No, that's ridiculous. 3/5, that's more than a half. 1/3, that's less than a half. We can't just subtract 2 from the numerator and denominator. That doesn't make any sense at all. When you're doing something, when you're doing some arithmetic, you're working with variables, make sure that what you're doing is actually valid. Think about what good math rule says that you can do that. There's no good math rule that says you can just subtract and add things from both of the denominators there. We can multiply things, and the reason that works, the reason we can multiply the top and the bottom here, and we can multiply the top and the bottom of 3/5 by 3, is because what we're doing is we're strategically multiplying by 1. Right? All we're doing here is multiplying by 1. If you multiply 3/5 by 1, you don't change the value. That, of course, gives us 9/15. And then for 2/3, we multiply the top and bottom by 5. Say it with me. We're strategically multiplying by 1. That's right. It's perfectly good math rule. We've got our common denominator, and now we can subtract. Now that our denominators are the same, we take the difference of the numerators. 9 minus 10 is negative 1, so this comes out to be negative 1/15. So let's go back to our problem. Now we know how to handle this. We're going to find a common denominator. We're going to get that common denominator by multiplying the denominators. What are we doing here? Say it with me. We're going to strategically multiply by 1. There you go. We got it. So we'll start off with 3c plus 1 over c minus 2. And we will strategically multiply by 1. We're going to use as our common denominator c times c minus 2, so we have to multiply here by c over c. And in the numerator, well, we're going to have 3c plus 1 times c, and in the denominator, as planned, we're going to have c minus 2 times c. We can break out the distributive property, multiply these out. C times 3c, that'll give me 3c squared, and then 1 times c is just c. And in the denominator, c times c is c squared. And then minus 2 times c is minus 2c. All right, we're going to do the same thing for the other fraction. Start with 2 over c, and we're going to get that with this denominator, with the denominator c times c minus 2, by, once again, say it again, strategically multiplying by 1. There you go. That's why we can do this. All we're doing is multiplying by 1. And in our numerator, we're going to have 2 times c minus 2. And in our denominator, we're going to have c times c minus 2. And we just use the distributive property again. 2 times c is 2c. 2 times 2 is 4. And down here, c times c is c squared. C times minus 2 is minus 2c. And sure enough, we've got our common denominator. So now we can combine these fractions. So write down the problem again. We got 3c plus 1 over c minus 2 minus 2 over c. And we've written these here with the common denominator. And we got that common denominator just by multiplying our original denominators. And now that we have the denominators the same, we can combine them by subtracting the numerators. But we have to be careful here. We have to be very careful. We're subtracting the entire numerator over here. We're subtracting the 2c, and we're subtracting the negative 4. You put the parentheses in here. Parentheses are your friend. They'll remind you that you're taking minus a minus 4. If you forgot to put those parentheses in there, you'd go minus 2c, minus 4, and you'd get the sign wrong. You have to be very careful in dealing with signs when you're subtracting fractions. So now we're going to simplify this. We're going to distribute this minus sign. We've still got the 3c squared plus c. Got the minus 2c, and then minus a minus 4. Minus a minus, that's a plus. Again, when you're doing this subtraction right here, we're subtracting 2c minus 4 over c squared minus 2c. We're subtracting the 2c, and we're subtracting the negative 4. Minus a minus becomes a positive. And our denominator is still c squared minus 2c. And now we can group the like terms. We have still have 3c squared plus c minus 2c. That leaves us with a minus c. Then we have that plus 4. Again, it's not a minus 4. We got a plus 4 at the end there. And our denominator is c squared minus 2c. And after all that, we started off, we found the common denominator by strategically multiplying by 1 here. We used the product of the denominators as our common denominator. And then we could write the two fractions with the same denominator, and then we could subtract. Remember the parentheses so we can get our sign straight. And then we can combine everything into a single fraction. And finally, we are done.